Good morning to everyone. This is update for May 22, 2022, day 88 of the war, end of the date update. So we're gonna, as always, do little one general topic, and then we're gonna do walkthrough the front line. And as a summary, for those who are impatient, the situation on the front line has not changed. And as a general overview, it does look to us, and this is a very initial assessment, that Russian troops ran out of fuel near Popasna, where if you followed our videos, you know that they had some successes, but they were stalled for the past 2 days. We'll discuss that in detail once we're gonna get to that section of the front line. But this is just as a summary there. So if that's true, then it looks to us that the whole front line is start to freeze, like becoming like, you know, firm concrete line, because before it was very fluid. And if that's true, then this is probably where it's all going to. But this is very preliminary, as we said, it's a very preliminary assessment. Now let's actually look at a general topic, and we're gonna look at the weapons that Ukraine will get from various countries who support Ukrainian fight for independence. So today we're going to look at a German anti-air vehicle called Gepard, which is in English is Cheetah. So what it is, and Ukraine, so let's just go back. Ukraine is going to get 15 units of Gepard in early July, apparently, and then in total it will receive 50 units of Gepard. So what it is, let's just look in first what it is, and then we can kind of start to understand if it's going to be helpful, not helpful, or and how it can be used. So what it uses, basically used as a base, it uses a German tank, Leopard 1, which was developed in the 50s. So it's essentially kind of rough equivalent of a Soviet T-55 tank. It has like still like old style armor, like basically from World War II type of armor. And it's only 70 millimeters of armor. So it's not very thick armor overall. It has two 35 millimeter Oerlikon guns, which were developed in early 50s. And the effective range of the guns 3.5 to 4 kilometers. Muzzle velocity is 1400 for armor piercing, which is essentially for any armor targets, and then almost 1200 for high explosive. And high explosive, it's against air targets, but also can be used against the infantry as well, right? So each gun has 20 armor piercing rounds, which is not huge, and then most of it is 320 anti-air, basically high explosive rounds, right? So if we look at the velocity, this for armor piercing round, it tells us that it's pretty good velocity, and it really means that the capabilities of this guns are pretty good overall. If, for example, just talking about armor piercing, right? Because high explosive, well, you probably need velocity for air targets, but for like just general infantry support, velocity doesn't matter, as you know, essentially at all. Then what is good about it? It has a radar. One is a search radar, which has a range of 15 kilometers, and it's the band is 2 to 4 gigahertz, and hopefully those who know more about radar technology can tell us if this is wide enough range for searching, you know, modern aircraft, helicopters, and UAVs. And then tracking radar has 12 to 18 gigahertz band and 15 kilometer range as well. There's also a laser rangefinder, and so as we said, the Ukraine is going to get 50 units. So as you can see, just generally, this as a philosophically, this is a kind of like a product of how to say World War II thinking in a way, right? To protect basically the idea is to protect tanks with this vehicle, right? Except at that time, you know, there were essentially no rockets in the early 50s that can be easily readily used, and so it uses regular cannons, right? So that's conceptually in general is kind of like to extend problem that it won't be able to successfully fight with the modern aircraft or modern helicopters. And the reason for that is actually not so much that the cannon cannot destroy, obviously, attack helicopter for sure it can. Their effective range is 3.5 to 4 kilometers. And so what that really means is that, and what happens on the battlefield, Russian attack helicopters, they attack from about 5 kilometers distance. And we discussed this in prior videos when, since Ukraine has now a lot of Stinger man-held anti-aircraft missiles, Russian helicopters and general airplanes are now super careful, and ground attack airplanes like Su-25, that's sort of the most dangerous one relatively, or Su-34, which is a tactical bomber. So this is kind of like the three main aircraft that being actively used by Russian Air Force to attack Ukrainian troops. Since, so basically going back to the situation with anti-aircraft support, now Ukrainian troops are saturated with anti-aircraft missiles. So now they basically, Russian air is attacking from kind of far. Like, for example, in case of helicopters, they attack from about 5 kilometers and we mentioned this before, by tilting their nose up and shooting those unguided rockets in the direction of Ukrainian army positions, which, as we said before, the success rate or effectiveness of such approach is very close to zero, essentially, right? So they just check mark, I did my job, right? That's what pilot says. So it's actually, it's in a way, it's a reaction from the pilots, and basically it's avoiding to do their job, right? Kind of like if you're very strict about what it is, right? The same is happening with Su-25. So what happens is that simply because of the range of the cannon, this cannon anyways will not be able to shoot them down because they don't even approach so close to Ukrainian troops anymore. Right. So, but where it's actually going to be super useful is actually the radar. Right. So it's basically kind of like a lightly armored radar, and it has range of 15 kilometers. So it can, if it's used properly by Ukrainian troops, that's another big question. Right. As we discussed, there's a lot of issues with effectiveness in Ukrainian army. But if they are used properly, they could be very effective in sort of early warning of their Russian air attack, right? So and that can dwarf most of the attacks, basically. So that's where they could be extremely useful for Ukrainian army, even though they look like a little bit like outdated weapon. And then obviously they can be used then against the infantry and all lightly armored vehicles. Except there is a problem because apparently this radar air, like this turret is probably super lightly armored, and obviously radars can be easily damaged. But so this is in nutshell about this this weapon, which is, if used properly, it will be very helpful for Ukrainian army. Otherwise, if not used properly, it probably will not give, it will not sort of help much. Now, let's actually go back to the front line. Let's do a walkthrough. As we discussed, let's actually go back to this map, like bigger old map of Ukraine. There is a continuing artillery ping pong along this border, so nothing changing there. It feels like it's a little bit intensifying, but this is, we're not really tracking it precisely, just from number of observations, number of locations. Feels like it's a little bit intensifying here. That's in nutshell. Now let's actually look at what's going on around Kharkiv area. So there are no changes in terms of territorial gains or losses. So the front line is stable at this point. What we're seeing here is there are subunits from the 80th Brigade, which was, if you remember, on Kherson bridgehead. We really don't understand the logic why they brought in here. And what is even more wrong in our opinion, and is that it looks like it's actually being split into two parts. We don't know like size of the each part, but part of it is here near Kharkiv, and the other part is actually near Severodonetsk. And so that's we discussed this problem of mixing up units, splitting them into smaller pieces, and not allowing them to function as a whole system. And this is that's a big problem, because it reduces capabilities of each unit once you break it down into, if they don't act as a coherent unit. So there was some comment from one of their viewers who thinks like, okay, it's okay to use smaller units, right? We're not against using smaller units on the battlefield, right? The company, battalion size, whatever, squad. What we say is wrong and really bad practice is actually when you separate units, basically you cut up unit into pieces, and then the whole unit does not function as a coherent system, because it was designed and envisioned to function as a coherent system, meaning that you need artillery support, you need like mortar support, you need supplies, you need everything. You break down like links, right, between their subunits, and that creates a problem when they don't get what they need when they need. So that's where the problem stems from, and that's creating huge mess even logistically. The resupply to just organize, it's a huge organizational mess that is usually a sign of a very difficult situation in the army overall. That's not a sign, let's put it this way, it's not a healthy sign. So having said that, let's keep going south. We're going to look at Izyum bridgehead. Then we're going to look at Lyman bridgehead. And this is all part of one big Donbas salient. And then we're going to look at Severodonetsk salient. So let's start with Izyum. So, this is schematic map. There is no progress, not totally like active attacks, just artillery shelling, kind of like reconnaissance fighting and all of that. So does feel more and more to us that there is no resources on the Russian side to continue attacking here the way they did. So again, the front line here is stable, being stable for quite a while, with the exception when this village Dovhenke was captured about a week or maybe 10 days ago. But that was the really last meaningful gain for the Russian side here. Ever since, they pretty much, it's a stalemate. There's no progress. Then let's look at the Lyman bridgehead here. And this one, it's being split, as we discussed. Now it's split into two pieces. One is around Svyatohirsk, small town here. And again, there are no changes here. Ukrainian side more or less holds the line here. And then there is a bigger one centered around town Lyman. That's why we call the Lyman bridgehead, because it was used to be one piece and now it's two pieces. So here again, the same situation. The Russian side does not even, it's totally probably clear to the Russian side that they can cut off supply routes and just retreat routes here in this area, because this is a major road. But it's very clear they don't have resources to do that. So again, in their front line, more or less stable here as well. So let's continue going. Let's look at what's going on around Severodonetsk and Popasna, because that was the most dangerous area for Ukrainian army over past probably couple weeks, and where the things were really on the edge and probably somewhat still are, but let's look actually. So the northern part has been stable since about what, May 8 or 10, when Russian army tried to establish several bridgeheads and suffered heavy losses near Bilogorivka. So this side is more or less stable at this point. And as you can see, Ukrainian army brought in a lot of various units. So most notably is 58th Brigade, and obviously it helped to stabilize situation here. Then some battalions from the 30th Brigade and something from the, again, some probably battalions from the 80th Brigade, right? We discussed this, that it's brought in from the Kherson bridgehead, and part of it is up north near Kharkiv, part of it is here. Again, we think it's a bad practice overall. Then what's going on here in Severodonetsk is that we mentioned that Ukrainian army lost the bridge here, where this, it says here, Pavlograd. This was main bridge in general that connects Severodonetsk to Lysychansk. So that's been lost, but in essentially there is no real meaningful bridge, but Ukrainian troops are being resupplied there. And it's in, you know, map probably is not terribly sort of informative, because there are obviously units of the 57th Brigade, because that's a, kind of like a major backbone that's holding front line in this whole area, right? And then there are battalions from the 115th Ukrainian Militia Brigade, right? They were brought in because the situation was kind of difficult here. They don't have obviously much experience, and they suffered some losses. There were a lot of problems with this unit here. Then we also hearing that there are some battalions from 4th National Guards Brigade. This is something new, and we don't know much about it, but there are some battalions. Again, it's probably brought in to support the defense of Severodonetsk and to be able to keep it. So far, again, there are no essential changes here. Ukrainian front line still holds here, despite the, as we discussed, much more difficult logistical situation here. Then let's look at the Popasna area, where there was clear success for the Russian troops for a while. For the past 2 days, there's no successes, no advances, basically, right? That's how we measure successes, are advances. And the first thing that we mentioned yesterday is it's very clear that the density of troops has decreased here meaningfully, and like really meaningfully. And so they lost their sort of their thrust, their ability to punch through Ukrainian defenses, right? There's no question that 24th Brigade is pretty beaten down. That's for sure. We also think there are some other units from these brigades here as well. We just don't have information on that. But for now, Russian side is clearly lacking resources to continue to exploit their initial gains. And we've been watching this for past 2 days, which really tells us that, okay, they might have been kind of like totally out of the fuel to continue attacks overall, just generally on this front line, or they might receive something eventually. We don't know. But for now, it's very clear there is a pause here. And it remains to be seen whether this is, that's it kind of moment, the last hurrah for the Russian side, or they will somehow manage to pull another card from their pocket and throw it here. But so far, it looks like this is the only place where they can potentially gain, like, you know, have any successes here. And again, as the time passes by, obviously Ukrainian side is probably bringing in more troops here and trying to patch this up. So the chances, as the time passes by, chances of Russian success here are also going down, right? And so the more time passes by, the more reinforcements they need to bring here. And as we discussed many times, at this point, ability to bring in reinforcements for Russian side are very extremely limited and potentially not available at this moment. We're not saying that Russian army is defeated or anything, just because there will be a lot of, you know, comments and Russian trolls and all that, those commenting that Ukrainian army is defeated. Russian army is not defeated. Ukrainian army is not defeated. This is just dynamic situation. We're explaining how dynamics of this situation works, right? If Russia does, you know, mobilization inside, there's obviously, there is more more soldiers to be recruited there than Ukraine can muster. There's no question about that. But for now, the situation has stabilized, apparently. But we'll see in the next couple of days. Could be wrong as well. We showed it yesterday. This is an approximate situation of the Russian sort of like most like so where they reached the most, because we show this because this is where the sort of thrust of the attack, because if they continue either go north or they can turn this direction and they can encircle either this group of Ukrainian group or the larger one here, right? So this kind of creates, they have the choice of opportunities for Russia, and so this is the most kind of dangerous situation. While this one is kind of like, okay, looks scary in terms of, okay, Ukraine can lose this town of Soledar, but in the end, the Russian side just does not have enough troops to kind of successfully kind of exploit and go all the way here. So the realistic pass and the most realistic is kind of turn here and encircle, at least kind of like chew at least a little bit, right? As opposed to trying to really go for the big goal. And so in our opinion, that's why we're showing this map, because that's where this opportunity lies for them. And this is where the most northern sort of where the most northern territories at Russian side captured. So as you can see, they're essentially, with exception of this village Vasilivka, their front line more or less goes along the railroad here, basically. So our understanding is that Ukrainian side uses railroad as a defensive position, which is good idea, because it provides cover from artillery fire. Because if you kind of create like a holes on the other side, it's almost it's essentially impossible to get those with artillery fire, and it will be extremely difficult with even mortar fire. So in the front line here near Kamishwaha, as we discussed, goes somewhere around this forest, somewhere here, basically. And there are no changes here again. So now this is a little bit like we kind of look a little bit also to the south of Popasna, where Russian side gained Troitsky, we discussed yesterday or day before yesterday. And then they tried to capture Vizhenka and they don't have success. So again, even here, the front line stabilized as well. So now we're not going to look at this section of the front line, because there is no active attacks, just artillery shelling there, mortar fire and all that stuff. So we're going to look straight west of Donetsk, where the Russian side is really just trying to squeeze out Ukrainian army from the whole kind of like Donetsk region and push it as far as possible from the city of Donetsk, because this is the capital, so-called capital of DNR, right? So they're trying to push Ukrainian army as far as possible here. So they had initial success here around Novobakhmutivka, which they captured, but so far they have not any successes. At the same time, they have not really tried. We mentioned this about a day or two before, that there was a large Russian unit, and we think maybe mechanized brigade, that was coming from basically east, that was spotted here, that we're seeing that will be used to kind of try to continue attacks here. There are no attacks by that unit today. So we'll see, it remains to be seen where it's going to be used. Maybe, Russian side decides to use it, pull it to Popasna, try to, maybe it's a last card and they try to use it near Popasna. So we'll see what happens here. But situation here is stable. And just local attacks as always around Marinka, Novomikhailivka, but beyond that, there's not much, really nothing to report here in this area. This is just a kind of like closer look at the whole area. This is this salient around Novobakhmutivka that the Russian side managed to capture. But situation so far, again, as we said, stable. So now let's actually go down, look at Zaporizhia front line. And we're going to look mostly at their eastern section of that. So as we always say here, right now, situation stable, both sides kind of in balance. Ukrainian side brought in 128th Brigade, Azov Cave Regiment, and that really stabilized the front line here. So there is no changes, just artillery shelling, and that's pretty much it, what's going on here. And this is just a larger look at the whole Zaporizhia front line. So as you can see, that's the only this wedge that Russian army managed to kind of create here. That's what we were talking about. So let's continue. Let's finish it with Kherson bridgehead. So let's have a closer look here. As you can see now, now it makes sense why the 63rd Brigade is here. Apparently that was replacement for the 80th Brigade that was pulled, and maybe even 14th. But apparently Ukrainian army thinks that this is enough troops to kind of balance the Russian side here. And as we discussed before, Russian side is definitely digging in this area overall. Okay, thanks for watching. That's it for today, and until tomorrow. Bye-bye.